move into the first formal plenary of the conference, and it is with immense delight that I introduce Vinay Lal. Professor Lal is on extended leave from UCLA and presently Professor of History at the University of Delhi. You can read his full, a lot, you can read a lot about Vinay, in fact, you just go Google his name. In fact, Google any of the presenters, particularly, you've been very active on the net, so there's a lot of material to read about what Vinay's up to. But he basically, he's an absolutely distinguished academic that could present to us today on this particular theme of a scholarly affair. He writes widely on Indian politics, history, culture, and his particular focus, for example, has remained in global politics of knowledge systems. He's written numerous books, and there will be some, in fact, booklets that will be available upstairs at the bookshop if you would like to actually purchase them that he has brought with him as well. And he's co-edited and worked and collaborated a lot with Ashish Nandi in India. And it is a great delight and an honour to be able to welcome Professor Lal here to speak to us today and to thank you very much for making it all the way from Delhi and to address this morning for the first presenter of the conference. Would you please come and address the conference?
Byron, thank you very much for the invitation. I would like to also express my thanks to Julie Burton and other members of the staff to whom I have not yet been introduced for facilitating my trip. And thank you, Byron, as well for that very warm and generous introduction. The more generous the introduction, the greater the expectations, the more onerous the task for the speaker. And therefore, the greater the perils, rather different than the ones described in this lecture. The title of my talk today is The Intellectual in an Age of Violence, Criticism, Ethics, and Democratic Futures. And let me tell you very briefly how I expect to proceed. I'm going to take as my initial point of departure a text by a very famous British Marxist historian. I'm going to dwell on it just for a couple of minutes. The point of that exercise being to see how we might be able to characterize the 20th century down into our times. And thereafter, what I'm going to do is I'm going to come to the principal subject of the lecture, which is what is the task of the intellectual in our age. And I'm going to take as the example of the intellectual the post-colonial intellectual. One could take other kinds of practitioners of cultural studies. The post-colonial intellectual apparently is one of the more progressive examples of the intellectual that we have had in the last three, four decades. And then I'm going to try to suggest what have been the limitations in post-colonial thought. I'm not going to dwell on the accomplishments and achievements of post-colonial thought. But the point of the exercise, again, is not to display a certain kind of pessimism, because in fact the subtext of all my remarks is to try to suggest what are the ways in which we can move forward with a rather different conception of the intellectual life in order to produce more ecumenical futures for everyone, not just for people living in the global north or for the elites in the global south. And I'm well aware of the fact that these are tentative heuristic distinctions. There is a global south within the global north. There is a global north within the global south, et cetera, et cetera. So I hope you will understand that, you know, that there isn't time to dwell on all of these nuances, but I'm well aware of the fact that one could complicate these arguments. And my inspiration here, to some degree, is Mohandas Gandhi, on whom I'm going to be speaking tomorrow night as well, who believed neither in the pessimism of the intellect nor in the pessimism of the will. So he effected a significant departure from both Schopenhauer and Nietzsche. Now, The text that I want to begin with is a text by Eric Hobsbawm called The Age of Extremes, The Short 20th Century, 1914 to 1991. And you might think to yourself that the dates that he's picked are really extremely obvious. Right? 1914 to 1991, 1914, the commencement of World War I, 1991, in the wake of the fall of the Berlin Wall and the decimation of the so-called Iron Curtain, you get the dismantling of the Soviet Empire, right? Of the Soviet Union. And so that's the dates by which this work is bookended. Now, I think if you pause to reflect on it, and you start thinking about what perspective is this being written from, the dates are anything but evident. So for example, let's begin with a very common rejoinder that this text is wholly Eurocentric. It is. If you haven't read it, you will certainly find it to be so. But that's a rather pedestrian objection, you might say. Well, we know that a huge number of texts are Eurocentric. But nonetheless, merely because it's pedestrian, it doesn't mean that it's not true. And then, of course, you might say to yourself, why did he pick 1914? Because after all, I mean, from my point of view, if I had to write a history of the 20th century, which I think I will in a few years, I would begin with 1898. I would actually make it the long 20th century, continuing down to the present day. I would begin with 1898, which is a year when the Boer War commenced, and that was the invention of the concentration camp, the Boer War, right? And I certainly wouldn't end in 1991. I would certainly take it all the way to, if I had to end in the 20th century, I would take it to 1994, which is when the Rwandan Holocaust, or genocide, took place, which is proportionately still the quickest and most complete genocide that we know of, proportionately, because it took place within a period of 3 months. 800,000 people were killed during those 3 months. But if we move beyond the question of Eurocentrism, the point is that even Hobsbawm's Eurocentrism is intellectually uninteresting, because 1898 is also the year that Freud published his Interpretation of Dreams, which it seems to me is as extraordinary a text as we can get for modern times. So even his Eurocentrism is palpably uninteresting, I would point out. But then yet, if you shifted the perspective to, let's say, the global south, in 1905, Japan administered a crushing defeat to Russia. And I cannot tell you how signal an event this was for nationalists living in places like India and Indonesia. I mean, you simply have to read the narratives of those times to understand that this was the most extraordinary event from their point of view, because this was a sign of resurgent Asia. Right? And one could go on in this way. I think you get the point, that the perspective is extraordinarily critical. But nonetheless, no matter how you mark the 20th century, how you bookend it, it is unquestionably an age of total violence. I think that is the most compelling fact about the 20th century. The estimates of the number of people killed in wars, genocides, holocausts. Notice, by the way, I use the word holocaust in the plural. I couldn't even do that in Israel, because there is only one holocaust from that standpoint, right? And to use a word in the plural is not to mitigate what happened during the holocaust in the period that we know as World War II and before as well, right? Commencing in the 1930s. But rather to point to the fact that there are many holocausts, visible and invisible, that have taken place. Okay? Now, if you include all of these, the estimate, a conservative estimate of the number of people killed is 200 million in the course of the 20th century, which is an extraordinarily large number. Okay? So it seems to me that this is the most compelling fact in some ways about the 20th century, and thus the title of my talk, The Intellectual in an Age of Violence, because then obviously the question is, what are the responsibilities of the intellectual? Where has criticism failed us? Where has it been inadequate? And what might we think about if we're going to think about more ecumenical and democratic futures? So as I pointed out to you, the paradigmatic instance of the intellectual that I'm taking here is the post-colonial intellectual. To some extent, I would refer to the text that itself became the paradigmatic text of the post-colonial intellectual. That is before Gayatri Spivak's short essay, Can the Subaltern Speak? But the text that really became the foundational text was obviously Edward Said's Orientalism, published in 1978. And a great deal has happened since then, obviously. There have been various kinds of critiques. If you look at India, which was one of the places where post-colonial studies became rather important, there's a particular Indian variant, as I would describe it, of post-colonial studies called subaltern studies, which was focused largely in the area of history and historiography. Fissures developed within that rather quickly. Because, for example, one of the founding members of that collective, Marxist historian by the name of Shumit Sarkar, decided within several years that post-colonial thought and subaltern studies had been massively contaminated, as he put it, by such things as postmodernism, right? And so on, and that the emphasis on class had entirely disappeared. So there's a long history of these fissures and so on, which I don't think I need to rehearse here for the moment. I only mention this here because it's important to understand the location or some of the locations of post-colonial studies. And as I said, I'm not really here at this point going to get into the question of what have been the accomplishments and achievements. What I propose to do really is to enumerate through 9 theses what are some of the difficulties that we need to think about and where post-colonial studies has been, it seems to me, substantially inadequate, right? Thesis 1, post-colonialism never mounted an effective critique of history. The French feminist Iri Garay speaks for many intellectuals when she voices the opinion that the dominant discipline in the human sciences is now history. She wrote this about 10 years ago. The likes of Saul Bellow and Alan Bloom argued that the Yoruba had never produced a Beethoven, Bach, Goethe, or Shakespeare. But no insult, not that that was not a small insult, but no insult is calculated to arouse as much anger, indeed outrage, as to suggest to a people that they have no history. Eric Wolff captured this idea in his book, Europe and the People Without History. However else colonized people may have been perceived by their vanquishers, they were often rendered as people bereft of history. Now, Iri Garay speaks of history becoming predominant in the present. History had, however, become ascendant much earlier, certainly by the early part of the 19th century. If we look at the case of colonial India, James Mill and Thomas Macaulay sought in the first half of the 19th century to demonstrate that Indians were not much given to rational thinking, and they adduced as evidence the lack of interest in history among Indians and the sheer inability of Indians to deliver even simple chronologies. Now, if any Indian was disinclined to believe the European charge against Indians, all that was required was to flaunt Gibbon, Hume, Macaulay, and later Ranke before the skeptic and ask if any Indian text could even remotely meet the standards of historical reasoning that had become commonplace in Europe. Now, as I've written elsewhere at great length in my book, The History of History, Politics and Scholarship in Modern India, nationalist intellectuals took it as their brief to respond to the colonial charge. Thus, the nationalist response remained oblivious to the consideration that Indians may very well have disavowed any intellectual or social interest in history, except that they did so for very good reasons and never saw it as a lack. I suspect that our forefathers, generations ago, would have been astounded by the idea that a sense of history should be construed as a sign of a people's capacity for rational thinking or the maturity of a civilization. Now, the relationship between history and the nation state has been well established. No sooner is a nation state born than an official version of the history of the nation in the making is authorized. This is the first thing, incidentally, that nearly every nation state does. You acquire independence, you immediately commission an official history of the nation state. Okay? Now, post-colonial studies practitioners have sought to show how all such histories are partial, often as oppressive as the colonial histories that they seek to supplant. This was one of the particular mandates of subaltern studies, to show the complicity of nationalist and imperialist historiography. Right? One response has been to ensure that those who were written out of history, women, religious minorities, ethnic minorities, and others, are written back into histories. Now, that such enterprises may be nothing more than additive histories, barely questioning the template of dominant histories, is, I think, also well understood. The resurgence in world history in the United States has been another response. And its many defenders and practitioners have been fired by the noble sentiment that the history of the world should no longer be, as it has been so often, the history of the West. Of course, this is a very American kind of undertaking, because the assumption is that what is good for America is good for the rest of the world. So since America needs world history, so do we in India, Africa, Latin America, wherever else. Now, there have been other more sophisticated responses to the problem of history. I think the most sophisticated one is one that is known to you. I'm going to allude to it now. The patient of Murthy has made a case for provincializing Europe. Though the gist of his argument is, I might say, in many respects, encountered in Rabindranath Tagore's Nationalism, published in 1917. He has also argued, quite rightly, that the reference point for histories, even those of India, Africa, or Latin America, somehow always remains Europe. But Chakrabarti remains unwilling to disavow the language of history. Not only are all critiques of history made within the space of history, as he would argue, such is also the case for critiques of nation or of modernity, but he views history as empowering, indeed as a necessary tool of citizenship. The incapacity of historians, I would argue, to make any substantive contribution to contemporary debates, even those revolving around the question of historical truth and questions of evidence, was driven home when in 1992 the Babri Masjid, a 16th century mosque, was destroyed by Hindu extremists. I might also add as a little footnote that I teach in the history department and all my colleagues wonder what I'm doing there. My point then is threefold, suggesting in what manner we need to go well beyond the framework of post-colonial studies with respect to the question of history. First, a more radical reading of the particular ways in which a sense of history may be unproductive or disempowering is needed. One may have some form of historical awareness and yet not be committed at all to a sense of history. If the adage, a nation that has no history is a happy nation, is at all to be intelligible, it can only be so on the supposition that the task of forging a nation is a bloody one, and history is almost always complicit in such an enterprise. The historian need not be pulverized by the thought that such an argument is calculated to make her or him obsolete. Secondly, we shall have to enter into a more sustained conversation with other modes of accessing the past, among them myth. Now, if the choice word of abuse for the Marxist critic is romantic, for the historian, it is surely myth. And yet, who would want to settle for the historical narrative of the origins of a city, let's say Bangalore, Mumbai, or Rome, right? Why would you want to settle for the historical narrative when the myth is much more interesting and richer? Thirdly, if a persistent case has been made for remembering, an equally persistent epistemological, cultural, and philosophical case has to be made for forgetting. It may well be that certain forms of forgetting are yet ways to remember the past, but the postcolonial critique of history cannot be said to have even remotely ventured in this direction. Thesis two, postcolonialism has had nothing to say about the imperialism of categories. Now, it is nearly an axiom of contemporary thought that we live in a shrinking world, in a world of unprecedented transnational exchanges, global movement of peoples, flow of goods and ideas, and so on. Right, the world has never seemed smaller, some commentators argue, you know, the most cliched form of the argument, Thomas Friedman's, the world is flat, etc., etc., right? Now, there are obvious rejoinders of varying complexity to this notion that the world has shrunk and that information travels at immense speeds, not even remotely imaginable a mere few decades ago. Visa and passport regimes have been considerably tightened. I hold an Indian passport, I know this very, very well. Okay, when I'm trying to travel to Schengen countries, for example. Borders have never seemed so hostile and insurmountable, and walls in Palestine between India and Bangladesh, along the US border with Mexico and many others have come up where they never existed before, right? Free trade arguments offer relatively unhindered movements of goods, but no nation state will even remotely contemplate the free mobility of outsiders across its borders. Those living in the global south certainly cannot engage or indulge in the idea of wanderlust. Leaving aside, however, for the present, such obvious criticisms of the regnant ideas of the day about our so-called global village, what would a more trenchant critique look like? Now, there is much talk of knowledge cities and knowledge societies, and no one doubts that the sum total of our knowledge of the natural and social world is much greater than it has ever been before. But everything hinges on what we mean by knowledge, and what relation knowledge has to awareness, wisdom, perspicaciousness, and insight. Moreover, any pride we may feel in our capacity for knowledge is at once moderated when we begin to ask, whose knowledge, to what end, and for whom? Even as our knowledge of the world has perhaps grown, the means by which we oppress and remain oppressed have grown dramatically. Oppressive class relations, the military-industrial complex, feudal norms that stipulate the place of overlords and servants, the brutal exercise of sheer military force, all these have persisted through the advent of modernity. Nevertheless, there is little, if any, awareness of the fact that oppression is increasingly exercised through what I will describe as the imperialism of categories established by modern knowledge systems. What are these categories of knowledge bequeathed to us by the social sciences through which we are induced to comprehend the world around us, and how have these categories become nearly impermeable to critique? Now, one of my earliest books, Empire of Knowledge, Culture and Plurality in the Global Economy, is largely orchestrated around the idea that if knowledge helps to liberate us, it also enables a more thoroughgoing and rigorous oppression than anything else that we have so far encountered. Even concentration camp inmates understood that it was possible to be broken in the body, but not in the mind. From there, we move to the more complex idea that the interpretive categories through which we understand the world have shrunk rather than grown, even as disciplines have developed and multiplied, and the entire knowledge industry has grown by gargantuan proportions. Right? And when I say knowledge categories and imperialism of categories, to cut to the chase, we might want to think of it this way. Why is it that the idea of the nation state holds up in such extraordinary captivity? Right? Why is it that the categories of the social scientists, whether they're working in Africa, India, the United States, or Europe, are categories such as development and growth, poverty and scarcity? Right? These are the key terms. You know, Paul Samuelson's economics textbook was the industry leader for about four decades. Translated into 45 languages, used in 80 countries, including constitutional monarchies, democracies, totalitarian states. You might be a totalitarian state, you're still going to use Paul Samuelson's textbook. The template has been laid down, right? Or if you look at the idea, let's say, of poverty, the economist, of course, almost never thinks dialectically. He or she would never think of saying, well, I'm going to try to understand poverty by writing a history of the super rich. Right? That might be one way to write a history of poverty. So that economists cannot distinguish, for example, between the poverty that one is born into, the poverty into which one is forced, the poverty that the supposed victim imagines as a form of wealth, the poverty that draws a line between needs and wants, the poverty that stands forth in repudiation of consumption, the poverty that becomes, as in the traditions of renunciates and warrior saints, one's armor, and so on. Farsi has 35 words for poverty, and the reason it has 35 words is to distinguish between all these different senses. Indeed, as in many post-industrial societies, most particularly the United States, the poor are despised only because they cannot partake of the consumer society and are therefore traitors to the notion of the ultimately good life. How did a category such as literacy, let me conclude this portion with a discussion of literacy. The word literacy is very different than the word literate. Okay? They have always been literates and illiterates. If you look at the Oxford English Dictionary, it will tell you that the word literate has been around in the English language since 1432. The word literacy first entered the English language in 1883, 4.5 centuries after the word literate. And the reason, of course, is that literacy is an evaluative scale. It's a measurement. So when you want to rank civilization, you say, what is the literacy rate of the United States or Germany in comparison to the literacy rate of Rwanda, Somalia, India, Bangladesh. Right? It's no accident that the idea of literacy arose in the age of eugenics. Right? But literacy is still one of the three criteria used by the UN Human Development Report to rank countries in terms of how developed they are. Okay? So this is what I mean when I speak about the imperialism of categories. Thesis 3, post-colonialism, for all its critique of the nation state, disowned the idea of civilization. The nation state is the only game in town. And since we have a conception of finite games, this game has winners and losers. Right? Well-meaning people like to speak of win-win situations and hope for such outcomes, but the relentless logic of the nation state permits no easy consolations. One modern narrative about the renewed ascendancy of China and India shows us as clearly as anything else how modern political discourse has succumbed entirely to the zero-sum politics of our times. There's a very prolific literature now about the rise of India and China, and the vast proportion of this literature all has to do with, well, which country has more cell phone connections, which country has been able to reduce the number of people living in poverty, which country has more hospital beds, right? Which country has, you know, bigger cities, etc., etc. Right? GNP, which country has the greater foreign exchange reserves? We know which country does in all of these cases. But that's basically the tenor of the comparison. Now, of course, the interesting thing is that long before India and China entered into this race, they had long civilizational ties. Somehow, that discussion never enters into the comparisons of India and China. And it's rather astonishing, by the way, that if you look at Edgar Snow, a very well-known journalist of his times who wrote widely on China, in 1931, and the Soviet Union, in 1931, he visited India. And what struck him most was the fact that these two ancient civilizations, which had had extraordinary ties with each other, one of the most well-known manifestations of those ties, of course, is the fact that Buddhism went from India to China. And their Buddhist texts, which today survive in Chinese, which do not survive in any Indian language, a long and complicated reasons for that, okay, right? But when Edgar Snow went to India in 1931, what he witnessed was, and this is essentially his words, that the only contact that India and China had was with each other was through Europe, right? Notwithstanding the fact that they've had a long civilizational connection with each other extending to millennia, right? And so the question for us really is, why is it that the discourse of civilization was hijacked? Why was it subverted? And we know that there are obvious reasons for it. We know that the word civilization came to carry various kinds of connotations which can hardly be considered to be salutary, right? We know the idea of the civilizing mission. But nonetheless, I think that there were people such as Rabindranath Tagore who recognized when he wrote his book Nationalism in 1917 and certainly recognized what the idea of civilization mission had done to countries such as India, that there was no other countervailing force to the idea of the nation state except the idea of a civilization. If you're thinking of large collectivities and how people organize themselves, we have to in some ways resuscitate the idea of civilization, that the idea of a civilization accommodates ambiguity and pluralities in a way in which the idea of the nation state simply cannot do so, right? Thesis 4, post-colonial thought has had an indifferent relationship to the idea of nonviolence. The enterprise of making a nation, as I've already suggested, is fraught with violence. People have to be not merely cajoled, but browbeaten into submission to become proper subjects of a proper nation state. Now, post-colonial thought, for all its attentiveness to the politics of nation-making and nationalism complicity with colonialism, never adequately wrestled with the various phenomena that can be accumulated under the rubric of violence. And it had even less time to spare for nonviolence. It is characteristic of most social thought in the West that it has been riveted on violence. Nonviolence is barely present in intellectual discussions. Think again back to Hobsbawm's book, right? 1914, 1991, right? We see here history's continuing enchantment with events. Nonviolence creates little or no noise. It merely is. It only fills the space in the background. Now, one of the many genuine insights at which Gandhi arrived was a recognition that the practitioners, theorists, and ardent believers in nonviolence have become entirely marginal to dominant intellectual traditions in the West. The Tolstoy who turned to philosophical anarchism and nonviolence was seen as having betrayed the finest humanist traditions that he had once embodied. Henry David Thoreau was dismissed as a freak, right? And Edward Carpenter was reduced to obscurity. Now, Gandhi was inclined to view Christianity as a firm repudiation of Christ's teachings on nonviolent resistance. The point cannot be reinforced enough. Nonviolence has never had any salience in Western thought, and post-colonial thought has in this respect scarcely deviated from the intellectual traditions of the West. Once we leave aside Indian scholars such as Partha Chatterjee and Ashish Nandi, for whom Gandhi has perforce had an inescapable presence, we find that post-colonialism and the Western academy never had the slightest truck with the histories and practices of nonviolence. Right? The most telling example of that, of course, is Edward Said, who had absolutely no time for Gandhi whatsoever. And it's very interesting, incidentally, that if you read a very large collection of interviews published with Said, a volume edited by Gauri Vishwanathan, one of his former students, you find that Martin Luther King is mentioned twice in this very large collection of 500 pages, both times mentioned not as the ardent champion of civil rights that he was, but mentioned merely as a Zionist. Whether that charge is right or not is a different matter, but this is the only mention of Martin Luther King that occurs to somebody like Edward Said. Right? I found it absolutely extraordinary that this should be the case. Right? Nonviolence, in short, has been a gaping hole in post-colonial thought. And I would say, more broadly, in cultural studies. Thesis 5, South-South dialogues should command our ethical and political allegiance. Now, as I move along, I'm going to have to truncate my points because I see that I'm already getting close to the end of the time. I'm going to truncate my points very considerably. Let me put it to you this way, thesis 5. Why, we might ask, must the West mediate between the conversations that the people of Asia and Africa might have amongst themselves? Right? Post-colonial studies may have familiarized South Asians with the writings of Ngugi Eshebe, Derek Walcott, Jamaica Kincaid, and Africans, conversely, with the writings of Kipling, Forster, Rushdie, and Amitav Ghosh. But the mediation of the academy in the US and UK has been central to all such enterprises. Right? Now, as a historian, when I think about this enterprise called comparative history, I usually have to chuckle when I think about it, because comparative history usually means comparing China with the West, India with the West, Africa with the West, Latin America with the West, right? In other words, what it usually means is, well, the West is one fixed point, and then the other one is determined by the national origins of the scholar. So if I'm an Indian, usually it means India and the West. For all the Africans I know, for them, comparative history means Africa and the West. Nobody would think of doing Africa and Latin America, for example, right? I mean, it's extraordinary if you think about the enterprise of, right, comparative history. But then the real substantive question behind that is, why is it that all of the conversations between the global South, why are they always mediated through Europe or the United States, right, or the global North in some fashion or the other? And this was not always the case. I mean, if you look at the Indian Ocean word from the 10th century to the 14th century, a word encompassing China, the east coast of Africa, Southeast Asia, the Gulf States, the South China Sea, India, this was an extraordinarily fertile word, where the conversations were between these actors that I have enumerated. All right? Afghanistan, which is now a byword in Europe and the global north for backwardness, relentless patriarchy, and the tyranny of the Taliban. Well, Afghanistan had extraordinary links with India, and North India was ruled by Afghan kings who were considered the model of civility for three centuries. And so on. I think one could continue ad infinitum here. Right? But this is what I mean when I say that we have to think about South-South dialogues, and these cannot simply be dialogues between the nation states of the South. In fact, those dialogues are already compromised because the idea of the nation state is already severely compromised. Thesis 6, doubtless probably the one that's going to be most controversial. In incommensurability, not interculturality, is the promise of more democratic futures. Now, one narrative of colonialism insists that however adverse the consequences of colonialism for the peoples of Americas, Asia, Africa, Latin America, Polynesia, and so on, it opened up these worlds to the modern West and its scientific, technological, intellectual, and political advancements. Now, we know what the opening up of Australia and the Americas, to take two obvious and gruesome examples, meant for indigenous peoples, right? And I don't have to rehearse those histories here. What I do wish to point out is this, in a very truncated form now, that the opening up of the global South to post-colonial